Two elderly women are at a Catskill Mountain resort, and one of them says, "Boy, the food at this place is really terrible." The other one says, "Yeah, I know, and such small portions." Well, that's essentially how I feel about life, full of loneliness and misery and suffering and unhappiness, and it's all over much too quickly.
I think, unlike most artists, there's no discernible line as to when his so-called personal life ends and his public works begin. His life is his work, and he incorporates everything. I won't say everything, but I'll say a great deal of what is going on in his head and heart in his films.
Don't you see the rest of the country looks upon New York like we're left-wing communist Jewish homosexual pornographers? I think of us that way sometimes, and I live here.
I'm going to buy you these books, I think, because I think you should read them, you know, instead of that cat book.
That's pretty serious stuff there.
Yeah, because I'm obsessed with death, I think. It's a big subject with me, yeah.
Do I believe in God? I'm what you would call a teleological existential atheist. I believe that there's an intelligence to the universe, with the exception of certain parts of New Jersey.
To most people, the character called Woody Allen is a fast-talking, awkward, permanently adolescent misfit, obsessed with love, death, sex, and matters arising, but most of all with himself, whose natural habitat is an analyst's couch somewhere in the Upper East Side of New York. By doing battle with his anxieties and fears, and by getting us to laugh at them, Woody Allen has become the kind of film hero who gives us all hope.
Chapter 1. He was as tough and romantic as the city he loved. Behind his black-rimmed glasses was the coiled sexual power of a jungle cat. Oh, I love this. New York was his town, and it always would be.
The city of New York is the setting and background for his best-known films, and it's also where the real Woody Allen lives and works, the center of his universe, with the whole continent separating him from Hollywood. He's a shy and intensely self-critical man who shuns publicity, a hard-working and thoughtful writer of plays, short stories and films, an actor who took years to perfect his own style, a disciplined and demanding film director who asks for and gets total control over his work. With one major film a year to his credit since the late 1960s, he's become America's most prestigious comic artist, in the unique position of being able to make the films he likes with the people he knows at the pace which suits him best.
I have a long-term arrangement for making films, so it's not that I have to get an idea and sell somebody the idea and go find an actor to play it and spend 2 years making deals with people and going to lunch and doing all that nonsense. I have a number of ideas for films, many more than I could make really in my lifetime. And when I'm finished with a film, I start to pull out one of these ideas and work on it, and it doesn't take me that long to do a script, and I don't shoot them interminably. So one film a year is not, you know, it's not that big a deal.
This special arrangement must be helped by the fact that over the years, you've also built up your own extended family of actors, with people like Diane Keaton, Mia Farrow, Tony Roberts and Diane Wiest. How important to you is this repertory company approach?
I would always work with people that I know, because it's just much easier for me. It's difficult for me to to do a picture with someone that I don't know at all, because you never know what's going to happen. I have no idea whether the person is going to be easy to work with or difficult or is ready to work in my kind of style.
Oh, don't, Boris, please. Sex without love is an empty experience.
Yes, but as empty experiences go, it's one of the best. Who would believe that such a beautiful girl would date me?
Come on.
No, I'm telling the truth. I mean, it's the Emmys, my hand to God.
Beautiful.
No, sweetheart, I'm telling you, and I see a lot of singers and actresses. You are.
Well, you're not so terrible.
Yeah, I know one thing, honey. I'm never going to be Cary Grant. I don't care what anybody says.
If I finish a film, I can call up Diane Keaton or call up Mia or Diane Wiest and say, I have a great idea for a new scene. It's better than the one we did. Let's meet in 2 weeks and do it. And they say, sure, because they live near me, and it's very informal and easy.
The atmosphere on the set is wonderful. Usually it's the same crew from picture to picture. Same makeup people and hair people and wardrobe people and many of the same grips and lighting guys. So there's a feeling of family about everyone. He's very open to suggestions. He'll very often ask if you're comfortable with the line that he has written. And he will change something for somebody if they feel uncomfortable with the words. He'll switch it around, or he'll tell them they could say something else, or very often he'll say to them, what would you like to say? And I think, perhaps my own suspicion, I don't know that this is true, but that process is part of where the line gets blurred between what's part of his life and part of his reality of the moment, or his spontaneity and his filmmaking.
Woody Allen doesn't like being confused with the characters he plays, but he always is, largely because his most popular films have an autobiographical feel to them, with this constant blurring of the lines between life and film. Most notably, his on-screen relationships with Diane Keaton and Mia Farrow seem to mirror his off-screen ones, and his work is full of flashbacks to his own childhood. Alan Stewart Koenigsberg, as he was then known, was born in Brooklyn, New York, in December 1935. He was a shy, withdrawn child who spent as much time as he could teaching himself magic tricks, learning to play jazz clarinet like his hero Woody Herman, and listening to serials on the radio. In high school, age 15, he started sending jokes to New York newspapers and had them published under his pen name, Woody Allen. After a brief, unhappy spell at New York University, with his sights set on being a playwright, he became the youngest member of NBC Television's comedy writing department. By the age of 22, he was earning $1,500 a week writing gags and sketches for top-line TV comedians like Sid Caesar. But in the early 1960s, he gave up the relative security of television work to become a stand-up nightclub comedian, a very nervous one at first. Over the next few years, the Woody Allen character, obsessed with psychoanalysis, sex, and Jewish family life, not necessarily in that order, became the centerpiece of his act.
I was in group analysis when I was younger, because I couldn't afford private. I was captain of the latent paranoid softball team. We used to play all the neurotics on Sunday morning, you know? Nail biters against the bedwetters.
By 1964, he was one of the most successful comedians in the business. Hollywood producer Charles Feldman saw his act and hired him on the spot to write What's New Pussycat, billed as a swinging 60s sex comedy. It proved to be a frustrating experience.
Fault strictly of the producer of the film, he just had no feel for that kind of material and overproduced it. You know, I was very fortunate. It was my first script, and we got Peter O'Toole, you know, who's still one of our truly great actors, and Peter Sellers, who was as great a comedian as I've ever seen, and a director who I liked very much at the time, named Clive Donner. And they were lifesavers on the project, but there was nothing much anybody could do because it was one of those big Hollywood-style movies and too much was being dictated from the producer in the front office.
I think that with you, sex is a sport,
yeah? Oh, yeah. I love the smell of perfume and the thrill of the chase and the moment of conquest.
I like thighs. Do you like thighs?
I had said a long time ago that if they had let me make that picture, you know, that I think it would have been a better picture but would have made infinitely less money. It was a very big success financially, undeserved, I thought. But we all struggled. The director tried his best and I tried my best. We stood together against the incursions by the Philistines, but neither of us had any real clout.
I beg your sweet pardon, I'm being chased by a maniac. Could you help me?
Quick, get in the closet.
In the closet. Closet. Thank you very much. Oh, Victor, I can't let you make love to me with a person in the closet.
Why? How many people in the closet do you need?
If What's New Pussycat provided Woody Allen with plenty of credit, but no control over his material, its huge success as the highest-grossing comedy of all time up to then became his launching pad.
My wife is coming. I've got to hide. Quick, get in the closet.
Yes.
It gave him the chance to write and direct his own first film, a send-up crime documentary with Woody playing a born loser. Take the Money and Run was his apprenticeship as a filmmaker.
Does this look like gub or gun?
gun, see? But what's ABT mean?
ACT, A-C-T, ACT Natural. Please put $50,000 into this bag. ACT Natural. It's not...
Oh, I see. This is a holdup.
Yes.
May I see your gun? Well, you'll have to have this note initialed by one of our vice presidents before I can give you any money.
Rush.
I really learned very little on my first film, actually, in terms of craft. I was sure that I could be funny, that I could write funny things and present funny things and perform them. But I didn't know the first thing about filmmaking, or not the first thing. I knew this, though, that it was going to be a pseudo-documentary in style. So I had something to hang on to.
Virgil Starkwell is apprehended in the act of bank robbery. He is given 10 years in the state's strictest maximum security prison.
There was probably a stronger plot in it when I wrote it, but when the thing finally came out and I was forced to cut out lots of material that didn't work and quickly put in other material that would work, probably the net effect is a series of gags.
The prison has not been built that can hold me, Virgil tells another inmate, and I'll get out of this one if it means spending my entire life here.